causes of such a revolution. But because we, I think that we have no longer time to talk. We have to be really fast in implementation to change something if we want to survive. And first of all, we have to change our mind, because our mind was educated in the past. And so we are trapped by ourselves. And so this is the outline, but I skipped some parts of that just to save time. And then, so I, digital transformation, I think that we already know what it is. And I would like to focus on conscious versus unconscious evolution, just to give you an idea of how we can change our mind if we apply strongly. And so, you know that this is my preferred motto, the self, verità voyage, se le pas d'allèvres, non lo paysage. And so that is your research journey is not just to discover new countries, new territories, but to have new eyes. Okay? And that's the most difficult part for us today, because we were educated in the past with the reductionist education. And so conceptual clarity more than instrumental obsession, so typical of this particular time, is necessary. Furthermore, a subtle transformation is ongoing, however. Both linear and nonlinear techniques are forms of predicative modeling. Think about that, predicative modeling, linear modeling. The difference between predicative and impredicative systems and models and definition is pervasive and often considered of marginal interest in the past century by a reductionist approach. But the difference between predicative and impredicative reasoning or systems is fundamental. Predicative approach can be part of the impredicative one, but not vice versa. And so this is my little schema that I published many years ago, that is you have to read some papers just to understand that in detail, but just to give you an idea that is we were trained to by discipline in training to be really good in synthetic and analytic thinking, but not in intuitive one. So we have to take into consideration even the fourth part of the story. And you know, we usually use the main center of your brain for consciousness that are just on the cortex, but the cortex captures only 70% of our total neural count of our brain. 82% is just in our cerebellum. Think about that. And 1% is all the rest. So the human mind brain has a genetic disposition, desire to create value, but we don't use that. Or we use that in the wrong way. The more value you can create, the more success and happiness you can achieve. While value is a subjective judgment in our minds, in nature, the relative value of all things, tangible and intangible, is concrete and shareable. Surviving. The central question of life, love, and leadership is, what choice can I make in action, can I take in this moment to create the greatest net value for me and for everybody? And so, just to have something to follow, I refer to the elementary pragmatic model. If you don't know this approach, I just suggest you to go online and type EPM, and you find a lot of material. But just to simplify things, two couple of fundamental processes are the core of human mind. That is process A and process B. So process A, conscious process and subconscious process, just to make things as simple as possible. So process A, wiring and rewiring our focus on optimal path, FOP, to creativity reach a better goal. And process B, process A, rational assessment and endorsement, continuous checking, plus FOP updating if needed. And so in that way, we can take into consideration the two major components of our geologic thought that are the paleologic thought with all the that those features, and then the neurologic thought with the other features, and together they can support us for human creativity. And so process A is fed by definition, adapting and compromising mainly. The availability of an environmental chaotic information redundant support is required. We use the right anterior temporal lobe for that process. And so we start from emotion, FOP, rewiring or rewiring, sensation and action. This is survival oriented. And then we have the process B that is based on opposing, complementing, and commanding. Clearly defined formal rules are required to actively operate emotion, sensation, and then perception, gateways to action. Learning oriented, solution path, logic articulation, checking, translating, and so on. So you see, process B is the conscious process, and process A is the subconscious process, usually. And then we use the kind of resources to define intrinsic value, extrinsic value, systemic value according to Atman axiological value definition. Usually, with the reductionist approach, we use only the systemic value. We don't take into consideration the extrinsic value and the intrinsic value of the process. And furthermore, we can decline those values in two different ways that are outer universe, so shareable, empathy, practical judgment, system judgment, or inner universe, self-esteem, role awareness, and self-direction. And so, this is just a summary of the story, that is the fundamental diagram that I always use to show you that with a reductionist approach to solve a problem, we focus only on the direct space. We don't even think that there is something else we can take advantage of. As a matter of fact, we have three more components of our information space. The co-direct space, the reciprocal space, and the reciprocal co-space. So you can get the illusion that then we lose only 75% of the information. But that's not the case. We lose just much more because not considering those three components, we don't take into consideration all the relationships we have with them. And we just ignore, and even worse, the cross relationship with them. Only crystallography was the only science that took in consideration the relationship between direct space and reciprocal space. But then that was used just for a little part of the story. But then you see the green line, then the green line is just the balance between the outer space and the inner space, if you are a balanced person. And you see the circle, that is the point if you are a centered person. So balance and centering are two fundamental actions that you have to use on yourself to interface with the world in the right way. But the point is that the green line and the centering point are dynamic, are not static in that way. So are always self-adjusting according to the different perturbations that you get from the world. And so we, in that way, can develop two different paths for understanding. In particular, if you take into consideration complexity is the possibility of separating a system from its content, a living being from its environment, an object from its measuring instrument. I think that those are the simplest definition of complexity you can get on books. Any other of them would be page blocks. Unfortunately, from the reductionist approach, we have this kind of limitation from mathematics. Mathematics was considered by humans with all our limitation. And so we focus on the continuum hypothesis assumption without realizing that when you get something, you have to pay a price for something, even if that pain is invisible. And what we are paying is infinite precision by default, that somebody can think, oh, that is good. But that's mind masturbation. It is mental masturbation. Because those is just like conceiving asymptotic concept. And then we can want to apply asymptotic concept on the real world. And that's the origin of all this confusion. Because real wars require real endings that cannot be achieved with this kind of approach. And in addition, you have no self-oriented structure. Orientation is at the basis of a logic thought. And then every thought that we have comes from, as a root, from our orientation step. The first orientation step is the baby that is just turning her head to her mom. Okay? Just from the first second on this world. And then non-formation conservation, completely dissipation. So now we have two ways of understanding. The old one, the reductionist one, that is the red way, by default systems are simple, some of them are complicated, the cohesional systems are seen complex, weaker systems are exceedingly rare. Or we have the golden path, the yellow path, by default systems are complex, simple systems are limited cases, includes complicated systems, or complex systems treated as if you were simple, tend to generate weaker problems. Oh, don't tell me. Okay, so we have the quality of quantity to figure out. Big data analytics versus deep unity wisdom. The red path and the golden path. It's up to you to choose one you like most. And so, okay, I have no time to go into detail for the big data analytics convenience and deep unity wisdom convenience, but again, now we have a choice. We can, maybe for some kind of situation, the faster approach can be convenient. But then we have to be aware that it cannot be applied to living organisms. If we want some kind of modeling or some kind of reasoning applied to living organisms, we need both of them coupled together. Okay? The big data analysis and deep unity wisdom. And so, unfortunately, we are still are currently educated by the reductionist learning, which leads to action based on unaware approximated approximations. We must switch to evolutionary learning, which can create the right interactions with the complex world and universe based on aware, exact approximations. If our fifth major risk is to apply only short-term solutions to long-term problems, according to John Williams, as popularized by the recent book of Michael Lewis, then the biggest risk of all is to achieve a reduced awareness on our current ability to get new eyes. We can get new eyes if we like. You see the path there. Our biggest driver for social evolution is equitable development, must be our increased ability to get new eyes by appropriate education and evolutionary learning, anytime, in every situation. And so, conclusion. Look, the challenge of social evolution, because we are all shared this most planet, Earth, we have to learn to live in harmony, in peace, with each other and with nature. That is not just a dream, but a necessity to survive. And so we try to push this message even in our UN project with Roger Perros, with Rupert Sheldrake, Federico Faggin, Jerry Pollack, and Luc Montagnier. So, we try. If you want to know more, this is a commercial, at the end of the year, you can read more on Creativity Mind, my book, in cooperation with the psychiatrist that developed the EPM model. And then, but you think about that, you never have to forget that your major problem is yourself.